Keep all of our men and women in our armed forces and those in public safety in your thoughts and prayers. Thank you. Please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, good morning once again. I think it's spring. Not exactly sure what happened to spring, but... It was there. It was there a minute ago. Lots of things frozen this morning in downtown Pleasant Valley when I got up. So
I saw a woman at a Dunkin' Donuts, and I said, "So much for global warming." She looks at me. She says, "Well, this is how it manifests itself."
Yeah, there
you go. Who the fuck?
So we're going to start off as always with Positively Carol. And I will ask my colleagues if they have anything this morning.
Well, first thing, we have Seniors on the Go tomorrow. It's a large event at the Ag Center. And for the senior citizens who want to go out and see what's available to them in the county, it starts at 9 a.m. in the morning, I believe, and continues most of the day. So an invitation to attend Seniors on the Go.
We just had an economic development conference with Anabar Bassoon, and we got some more favorable news for Carroll County. We have the third lowest unemployment rate in the state of Maryland, second only to Howard and Montgomery. We have the highest graduation rate within our school systems. We have, what's the third thing I was going to say?
Lowest crime rate.
Excuse me?
Lowest crime rate.
Lowest crime rate in the state of Maryland. We're seeing a lot of, conflicting discourse in the media. A lot of it's politically driven rather than factually driven. The fact of the matter is that Carroll County remains, I would say, the most wonderful place in Maryland to live. Great schools, great teachers, great graduation rates, low unemployment. We were the largest adder, I believe, of manufacturing jobs in the state of Maryland. We added almost 100% of the jobs we added, I think, this past year were manufacturing, 1,000 jobs, something like that. We're doing very well in many, many areas, and we need to remember that we are what we say we are. We are what we say we are. We are still a great county, and in every dimension, economically, the quality of our workforce, our low crime rates, our high graduation rates, our good economic development, which continues to add jobs, we are always ranked at or near the top in the state of Maryland.
Okay, two other quick things this morning, and certainly I agree with both. The reminder on Seniors on the Go tomorrow is really important. Two recent things, and I like to bring it up because this continues to be the theme of how wonderful a staff we have here and what our staff does to go above and beyond. And a couple incidents here. We had an incident last week that required an emergency sewer line repair in the Sykesville-Eldersburg area, and a gentleman from one of the more popular restaurants down there, I think, was in a dilemma where he was going to have to close if he didn't get some intervention. Folks like Jason Green and our permits and Lionel Stickles jumped in. We had a plumbing inspector that went right out. Two gentlemen that dropped everything to take care of the problem. So all told, about five or six people that jumped in on this and got him back in business. Unbelievably quick. And he said, while I know you usually get complaints regarding your permits and utilities, I'm here today to tell you that it was an unbelievable job, and folks need to hear that, because sometimes we get jammed up with the negatives, and there are a ton of positives out there that far outweigh the negatives. I guess, to the theme of my colleague, Commissioner Rothschild. Sometimes we take for granted the fact that we got some wonderful things going on in this county. Another thing I'd like to bring up is from our Bureau of our Parks and Rec Bureau. There's a ton of things that our maintenance folks over there are doing to save us a lot of money. A couple of us recently, Commissioner Weaver and I attended the Rec and Parks Luncheon, and also our county administrator. I was taken out to see the pavilion that they put up, a brand new pavilion. Our folks did that and saved the county hundreds of thousands of dollars in labor as a result of them doing that. You know, a special thanks to them. I don't like to name a whole lot of names because I'd miss somebody, but all of the folks over there, our maintenance workers at Piney Run Nature Center are doing the same thing. They're doing things down there that they wouldn't have to do. And we're seeing hundreds of thousands of dollars being saved as a result of that. So if that's not positively care, I don't know what is. Okay, let's move on. Today's first agenda, and one of about three or four I believe we have this morning, is a briefing discussion decision on an option to purchase a county easement. And the first one I believe is the Sterner property. And we're certain, again joined by Deb Bowers, our program manager in Agland Prez, and our specialist over there, J.P. Smith, and
good
Tom's
morning.
Lurking in the background.
Good morning.
So good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good
morning.
We have some beautiful properties to show you this morning. The first two are the first ones to come before you from our FY16 cycle. So we're very pleased to be bringing them to you this early in the year, thanks to use of our formula for valuation. The first property is owned by Eugene Sterner, who is here with us this morning. It's at 501 East Sawmill Road. This property is actually split, you believe it or not. A little corner of it is in District 3. about 1.5 acres, Commissioner.
All right. But the most important thing to bring out is that most of it's in District 1.
Yes, the most important, yeah. Most of it's in District 1.
We let Commissioner Frazier wet his feet just a little bit at a time on this one.
Acre and a half. I'll take what I can get.
So it's 96 and a half acres. It has all conservation zoning, so you can see there's a very large number of lot rights being retired in this purchase for $46.66 per acre, total cost of $450,581. Here is an aerial of the property right off at Sawmill Road. As you can see, most of it is in cropland. Mr. Sterner has some cattle, and he operates the farm himself. And it's very productive ground. Here is how it lies in the Bachman Valley area. It'll be a very good addition to the area, seeing that it is retiring that number of lot rights. It'll be a good investment in what we've already invested in this very important farming
region. How many lot rights did you say?
24.
24, wow, okay.
And here are some nice photos of the property, and we would ask that you approve the option to purchase.
Mr. Frazier?
I'll make a motion that we approve the option to purchase an easement on Eugene R. Sterner property.
Second.
Okay, got a motion and second. Any other questions on this property? If not, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. That's unanimous. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The second property before you is owned by Esther M. Pierce. And others on Water Tank Road, just outside of Manchester in Commissioner District 1. 130.6 acres. It has 9 lot rights. We're offering $46.92 per acre for a total cost of $612,865. Here is an aerial showing lots of cropland, very productive ground. Here it sits by itself, and I just want to say it's sitting there by itself, but we have some other properties we'll be bringing to you that are in this immediate area as well in this cycle. And here are some nice photos of that farm.
Okay. Questions? Comments?
I move we exercise the option to purchase the easement of the Pierce property.
Second.
Okay, so motion and second. Anything else? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 And that's unanimous.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
And now we're going to offer you two options for rural legacy program easements. The first one, I think this might be out of order. You might have the Ruby listed first, but this one is for Paul and Laura Leister at 5150 Harney Road, Commissioner District 1. This is as far northwest in the county as you can get, way up in the far northwest corner. It's 61 acres. There were 8 lot rights on this property. The cost is $42.76 per acre, a total of $261,453 in state grant funds. It sits right next to the village of Harney, and it also has about an acre and a half over in Frederick County on the other side, which the Rural Legacy Program wishes for us to include. Since it is a state program, we will be including that acreage. We will not, however, be including the acreage that's in Pennsylvania.
Deborah, we have a slight discrepancy on cost. Our notes say $255.6K, and I think you said $261K.
Oh, yes. There might be a difference in your briefing. You probably have $255. We had to make an adjustment on that for that acreage in Frederick County.
So is our cost going up or down then?
It's going up, yes.
To what, 261?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Do we have an exact number for the record?
Yes, 261,453.
Now, can
and
they
one
get,
cent.
Can they get into the clean and green in Pennsylvania for the remainder or not?
They could.
Okay.
Yes, they could.
How many acres are in Pennsylvania? Do you know?
I think it's about...
I do not know.
I forget. Okay. 7 or 8.
Oh, is it? Okay. So
yeah.
it's a small portion of that.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I did contact Adams County to see if they were interested in doing an easement in case the owners wanted to contact them.
Okay.
Okay, there's the aerial. And now I wanted to tell you that also there is a small portion of this property that is included in the Village of Harney residential zone that we have excluded from this easement. It is 3.6 acres. So we had our county surveyor, Richard Krebs, survey that out for us, and it will be treated as a saving and accepting from the easement. So that will be included in as an exhibit in the easement. So that will be excluded. Here is the property, and as you can see, it's going to complete a pretty long corridor of protected lands along the Monocacy River. So the Rural Legacy Program was very happy to see this. We do have quite a few farms protected along the Monocacy up in that area. It extends down even farther than what you can see on this map. And here are some photos, and we ask for approval for this option to purchase.
Okay, any questions on this property? I'll make the motion to exercise the option to purchase this one.
Second.
Any additional? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 That's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And our last property is the Royce and Joy Ruby property on Shamer Lane. It's 39.8 acres in District 2. It has 4 lot rights. State grant funds that we will be using will be $151 and $162, at $37.92 per acre. The Rubies have a lot of woodland, and they've also been planting a lot of trees in the area that is not woodland, so this was an excellent rural legacy program for environmental attributes, not agricultural, but environmental. So it has a nice stream running through that will be protected in perpetuity, and the forest ground is in excellent condition. Here it is, in case you don't know where Shamer Lane is. It's off, runs between Hawksville Road and Coon Club Road, and near St. Paul, near the intersection of St. Paul and Hawksville.
So four lot rights?
Yes. And here it sits. It does connect with some other easement properties in the area, just outside of Hampstead. And here are some photos of the property, the tree planting that the Rubies have been doing for a good while now.
Would you back up that one slide? I just want to raise an issue. It will not affect our ability to put this into preservation, but I do want to bring up an issue for the commissioners and for the planning department. As we move forward, we have chains of properties putting them into preservation, such as here. You can see we have a gap in the middle, and also among the Monocacy River. We need to be careful about not creating what I'm going to call a developmental log jam in the future where we close off all access, or, you know, if God forbid we need to ever put a road across one of these areas or need access to a river for industrial purposes. We don't want to do such a good job of daisy chaining these properties that we create a roadblock to future developmental needs that could, we can't even begin to anticipate, but could affect our children or our grandchildren. So we should try to make sure we occasionally leave gaps in this development to ensure that we have at least more flexibility to reach critical resources or critical roads in the future.
I don't think that's going to affect this property.
No, it's not going to affect this property, but just something to think about in the future.
I move that we exercise the option to purchase the Rural Legacy, the Ruby property.
Second.
Any other thoughts? Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Unanimous again.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And Tom? I would ask in the future, as we review future applications, that we be sensitive to creating a daisy chain of properties that creates an impenetrable barrier in the event we needed to get across a piece of land for some reason.
Understood, Commissioner. I think that'll prompt some further discussion, I do believe. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much for your work on that. And for those folks that are in the room that represented these properties, thank you. We appreciate your efforts, and thank you for becoming a part of the program. So, appreciate it. Thanks. Okay.
This is Mr. Ruby.
I'm sorry, sir. I just wanted to thank the county, and everyone we worked with was phenomenal. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Okay. Moving on. Our next item is bid approval. Briefing discussion decision on a hot mix asphalt paving of 5 roads. And we'll be joined by our Bureau Chief of Engineering, Debbie Butler, and our senior buyer, Cindy Miller. Ladies, good morning.
Good morning. Commissioners, we are requesting your concurrence to award the project, the hot mix asphalt paving of 5 roads, to Gray and Son in the amount of $2,558,000. We did receive 4 bids, and Gray and Son is the lowest, and they are a very good vendor. We've used them numerous times in the past.
Where are they located? Where's Gray and Son located?
In Timonium.
Yeah, it's in Timonium.
They did one of our projects.
They have a blacktop plant in Finksburg, I believe.
Okay. They seem to get at least one. C.J. Miller usually gets most of them, but it seems Gray and Son usually gets at least one.
Yeah. Okay. See, you all thought I was going to ask that question, didn't you, huh? Surprised, aren't you? The 5 roads, Deb, can you tell us what they are, please?
I can, yes. Main Road, which goes from Beaker John Road to Union Bridge Road, Middleburg Road, Snydersburg Road, Stone Road, from the new paving portion that was done a couple of years ago out to Stone Road North, and Union Bridge Road. And it totals 18.6 miles.
When will this contract actually, when will they start work on this contract?
When will we start working on it? I'd say six weeks from now. Purchasing will send the contracts and bonds out to the contractor, and it usually takes them 2-3 weeks to execute all that.
My geography may be fine, but I just know that Don Wilson and Union Bridges had concerns about North Main Street there, which I think feeds into, is it Main Road?
It's in that area. I don't recall exactly where it is.
You know, and they continue to struggle to have funds to pave that, although they might get some relief, I guess, with there is going to be some road money, highway user revenue money for municipalities. I'm just wondering in the future, will there be any economies of scale of us trying to work with our towns when they've got a segment of a road that attaches to something that we're paving, or will there be any economies of scale of them trying to piggyback off of the larger paving contract as opposed to letting it a small section on their own?
We have done that in the past.
Yeah, and in this project and in all of our projects, we have a cooperative purchasing clause, mm-hmm. which allows, you know, the municipalities to piggyback on this contract.
Could you just let Don Wilson know that you're he may already know, let him know that you're paving the section, see if Union Bridge wants to do anything, and because they are going to get some HUR money, I believe.
And he's in Union Bridge?
Yeah, he's the president of the town council.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks.
This Stone Road again, Debbie. From where to where on that?
It starts where the new paving ends, the project that State Highway completed a couple of years ago.
Okay.
And then it goes to Stone Road North.
Okay. All right. I'm just trying to. I'm picturing that road, and of course I'm on it a good bit. And again, you know, I'm sure I'm going to hear from a constituent or two that says, why? Because the road seems fine. So I don't like to continually bring that up, but perhaps it's good. Sometimes there's a method to my madness here, that if people hear things over and over again, at some point perhaps it will stick.
Yeah, there are different segments to that road, and they are being treated differently. There is a section that's in much more poor condition.
Right.
And we're doing more extensive work on there. There is a piece that's in better condition, and we're just doing a thin overlay on that portion.
Okay.
So it's tailored to certain segments.
Good explanation. Because if you were going to do the whole thing, I was going to go, wait a minute now. Because I know that there are parts that would make you go, what? You know, okay. All right.
Yeah, and it does give a consistent surface, so it will weather and age uniformly.
Absolutely, and that's the bottom line. We tend to forget that we're treating these so that we can get longer life out of them and don't have to continually go back and spend the money on them. So you know, that's important too for folks to remember. Okay, all right.
I'll move we award the bid for the hot mix asphalt paving of the 5 mentioned roads.
Second.
DeGray and Son. Move to award it to Gray and Son.
To award
Gray and Son.
To award the bid, yeah. To
yes. Okay.
And all of this is in the budget. We're taking no additional monies out of the budget. This has all been.
That's correct.
Okay. All right. Any other questions? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. And that's unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next item is a request approval of a grant application, which is the Money Follows the Person Options Counseling Grant through the Department of Citizen Services. And we're joined by our Aging and Disability Supervisor, Gina Valentine, and Debbie's lurking in the background. Good morning.
She won't come forward.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning, Gina.
This morning, we're here to present to you and request approval and acceptance of the Money Follows the Person grant application. The purpose of the Money Follows the Person grant is to continue the MFP project in Carroll County. The program provides information to individuals residing in nursing homes and other institutions about services and programs that assist them with moving to a community setting. Some information about the program. Individuals in these settings who want more information about the services and programs that would permit them to return to the community are referred to the Bureau of Aging and Disabilities for something called options counseling. The protocol in this grant requires that we have a partnership and formal agreement with our Center for Independent Living, which is the Freedom Center. And in that agreement, our agency completes the options counseling for individuals 60 years of age and over, and the Freedom Center completes the options counseling for individuals 59 years of age and younger. We assist individuals with applying for programs and services through programs such as the Community Options Waiver, Community First Choice Program, Community Personal Assistance Services, and Increased Community Services. These are all Medicaid-funded programs that provide services for people to return to the community. The funding for this program, we are reimbursed $125 for each options counseling session that's completed. And we also receive an additional administrative reimbursement of $12.50 for each options counseling session that's completed. The projected maximum funding for fiscal year 16, this current year, is $11,000. However, we project that we'll complete approximately 70 referrals, and which would equate to $9,625. This is a contract renewal. In fiscal year 15, we completed 72 referrals, and in the first three quarters of this fiscal year, we completed 53 referrals so far. There's no county match required.
Okay. Questions on this? The additional monies that we don't use based on the units that we, what happened? Is that ongoing, or am I looking at it wrong, or what do we do with that?
The amount that's projected for us to receive from this year is provided by Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, so they're projecting that we would complete 80 referrals.
Okay.
But with what we've completed so far, with the number that we've received and the ones that we've completed so far, it looks more like about 70 referrals that we'll complete. So those additional monies, you know, will stay with Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. Should we exceed the 80 referrals, we will receive the reimbursement appropriately according to the ones that we complete.
Okay.
Just an estimation.
All right. Very good. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? If not, I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion that we approve the Money Follows the Person Options Counseling Grant application. Are we accepting the grant at the same time?
Yes.
And accept the grant award.
Thank you.
Second.
Okay. Before we vote, I think it's a good time again to remind folks of how the atmosphere is with all of these grants. You know, they continue to decline the ability to be able to get them, and the key here is having folks that know how to write these applications. And I will again point out that, you know, the likes of Debbie Staniford that you know looks at these things and is able to write these things is priceless for us in all aspects of these grants. It's incredible to me. I shared this story the other day. You know, it's one thing to go after grants. It's another thing to be able to get them, and you get them based on the way that you write them. It's not just throw things in a hat and they draw one out. It's it's how it's written and the content, and that's how you get these grants. So kudos, Debbie, to you and to all the folks that are involved here. It's priceless, and you know we've got to continue to be able to do that with the economics that we're involved in right now, and certainly in the fact that we're in the middle of a budget. That comes to light more importantly than ever. So I think I just want to, on behalf of everybody here, I want to say thank you for that, because a lot of these come by us, and we just sort of, okay, we're good. But you got to remember how we got to the point where we're getting these applications and the awards.
Yes.
And I think that's critically important. So thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Motion and second. Any other comments? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. And that's unanimous. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Gina,
Could you just hold tight a minute until we're finished a minute?
I don't think we have any public comment unless we
Mr.
always
Burke wants to say something.
We always welcome Mr. Burke to say a few words if you,
no comment today.
Okay, no comment. Excellent. All right. In that case, we are going to be back at 1:30 this afternoon to continue agency hearings, and I think we're going to hear from four this afternoon. So we'll be back at 1:30. Based on that, I'll entertain a motion to recess until 1:30.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
We are recessed. Thank you.
Carroll County government now streams live right to your smartphone. Go to carrollcountymd.iqm2.com.